Dr. Wade Davis is here. He's our fourth speaker. Explorer-in-Residence, the National Geographic Society. He's a visiting professor and senior fellow of the Masters in Development Practice, Indigenous Development Program here at the University of Winnipeg, and author of Sacred Headwaters, The Fight to Save the Stikine, Skeena, and Nass. Dr. Wade Davis.
Well, I'd like to thank all my fellow panelists, and most I'd like to thank all of you from Manitoba who have come out to support us from British Columbia. You know, my mother used to work in the Hudson Bay store right across Kitty Corner from here, and my grandfather actually died of Spanish flu in the streets of Calgary. My grandparents on my father's side were killed in a car accident on the Malahat Highway. And my great uncle was a fisherman off the shore of Newfoundland. You see, this isn't about British Columbia or Manitoba, it's about Canada. And we're all Canadians. And those who try to divide us by saying that somehow outsiders are sparking this resistance reflect the kind of ideological thrust of their position. You know, I was at Copenhagen. And it wasn't a proud moment for Canada. It wasn't actually a proud moment for any nation state. There you had China speaking about being allowed to increase their carbon intensity as long as it didn't surpass the steroidal growth of their economy, reducing carbon emissions only to the point where they could continue to grow. You had India basically saying, you screwed up the world for 200 years, it's our turn. You had the European Union calling for reductions that no other nation could match simply because through a sleight of hand by accepting the former countries of the Soviet bloc, they had achieved those reductions themselves without actually reducing anything of their carbon emissions. Saudi Arabia asked for compensation and the countries of Africa asked for reparations as if there had been a carbon conspiracy afoot since the birth of colonialism. Canada, of course, was famously mute. And it was a real turning point in our history where for the first truly multilateral conference on an issue upon which turned the fulcrum of the world, we had no leadership voice whatsoever. And what I found when I was over there as a kind of ethnographic observer was that the interesting thing was that the consensus in the scientific community was so absolute and complete that to question it was to question in the methodology of science itself. And yet the methodology of science is the foundation of modernity. So what we're really seeing is that individuals were cherry-picking their science, accepting science when it delivered us the miraculous achievements of medicine, and then denying that same methodology when it warned us of an impending crisis in terms of the climate. And I think all of us had this sense that as oil production declined, as we thought it might do in the 1970s and 80s, as natural gas declined, that somehow there'd be this generous or relatively simple transition to some kind of sustainable, transitional, and then alternative source of energy in our economy. Well, now with the discovery of so many new sources of hydrocarbon, alternative sources from the tar sands to coal bed methane, shale, fracking, we're suddenly discovering that we will have carbon with us for at least 300 years. So we really face a choice. We either want to do what many of my friends in Alberta have done, endorse and embrace ideology as a way of denying reality and therefore continuing the old traditional ways. And if we choose that path, all I can say is we better hope that the climate scientists and the universal consensus of the modern scientific community is somehow wrong. Maybe it could be, but I certainly have my doubts. Now, those images you saw as you walked in here, and I'm sorry that we had so much illumination here that you couldn't quite see them in all their glory, were photographs taken from my homeland, the Sacred Headwaters, this remarkable place in British Columbia whereby an accident, perhaps a miracle of geography, three of our most important salmon rivers, the Stikine, the Nass, and the Skeena, are born in the same meadows. In a long day, you can follow the tracks of white wolves and grizzly, caribou and moose, and walk through the meadows to give rise to the rivers, the salmon rivers of home that in turn cradled all the great civilizations of the Northwest Coast. The Tlingit, the Haida, the Haisla, the Nishka, the Gitsanwitsuatun, and of course the Tahltan. And the only place I know in the world where such a wonder of geography occurs is in Tibet, on the slopes of Mount Kailash, a mountain sacred to 3 billion people, from the base of which flow three of the most important rivers of Asia, the Brahmaputra, the Indus, and the Sutlej, and metaphorically and mystically, the Mother Ganga itself. Now, that landscape is considered so sacrosanct to the 3 billion people who live downstream, be they Hindu, Jain, or Buddhist, that not only are you not allowed to step on Mount Kailash or climb it, you couldn't conceivably propose industrial infrastructure unless you wanted to shame your lineage for all time. Yet we discover that in Canada, we treat the land very differently. What I find fascinating as we consider all of these developments, and it's important to remember that the Enbridge pipeline is just this sort of iconic symbol of a much bigger process, which is a tsunami of development in the north in reaction to the global increase in commodity prices. Now, this increase in commodity prices for a natural resource-driven economy is actually a fantastic opportunity because it allows us for once not to be in a buyer's market, but a seller's market. What I mean by that is traditionally in Canada, if a company came into a small town in northern Manitoba or Ontario, proposed a certain industrial initiative, the civic leaders had no choice but to accept the terms of that company for fear of losing the economic opportunity for their people. But we know that with this commodity increase that's not going to go away, we have the luxury of saying no and defining the terms by which we want to put in developments where we want to put them. So the issue isn't mining or no mining, gas or no mining, or no gas, oil or no gas, but mines where, at what pace, on what terms, at what cost to the environment, and for whose benefit. That actually allows us an opportunity to begin this process of moving away from this kind of antiquated resource-driven economy into an economy of the imagination. I've always felt, as a British Columbian, arguing for years now about seeking ways to transition our economy. Here we are, one of the richest countries on earth, incredibly educated populace, with any number of capacities for ingenuity and innovation, extraordinarily solid financial foundations, and yet we continue to elect these political leaders who tell us that the only way we can generate economic activity is to violate our own patrimony, the landscape, which is in fact the inheritance of our children. That's not a dearth of economic opportunities, it's an absence of imagination on the from the people that we elect to government. And the other thing we have to recognize is that the way we treat landscape is rooted in an ideology of the past. Think of what does it take to establish a mine in Canada? Well, you know, you get together on a golf course in Toronto, you cobble together a company with less history than my dog, you get online and you secure the subsurface rights to a place you've never been, the stories you've never heard, the pain of a long winter you've never experienced, nor the promise of a bright spring, and as long as you can guarantee the government a flow of revenue in the form of either royalties or taxation, you, by definition, you and your small cohort, secure the legal right to transform that land forever. Yet there's not a single metric in the calculus that rationalizes the industrialization of the wild that places any metric of value on the land transformed, or conversely, any cost to the commons, the rest of us who don't own stock in the company, who don't work in the mine, implicit in its transformation. Now, we take that as a given because it's the way we industrialize the wild. But if you look at it through the anthropological lens, it's highly anomalous behavior. It's a little bit like me coming into your garden in Winnipeg on a bright spring day, and your roses have bloomed, and you're selling roses, so I offer to buy all your roses. You sell all your roses, you're happy, I walk away, but I say over my shoulder, by the way, as a consequence of this transaction, I'm destroying your house. And you say, wait a minute, who's going to compensate me for the house? I say, I don't care. I'm buying roses. I'm buying coal. In fact, didn't I pay the sales tax on those roses? I certainly did. And the royalties from these roses. But I leave your house devastated. And that's exactly what we do. And one of the challenges is that we love the idea of the North in Canada, but we never go there. I remember when I went to speak to Premier Campbell about the unfolding situation in Northwest British Columbia, I was astonished to find that my own premier had never visited a quarter of the province. Can you imagine an American governor who had never visited a quarter of Illinois? It was inconceivable. But that's exactly what happens. Where I live in the sacred headwaters, it is so beautiful, as I hope those images began to show you. This is the kind of place you could hide England and then the English would never find it. In the lower 48, the furthest you can get away from a maintained road is 20 miles in the northwest corner of British Columbia, where all this is happening. There's one road, a narrow ribbon of asphalt that links the Yellowhead to the Alcan in the Yukon. The Grand Canyon of the Colorado is visited by 5 million people every day, and 24,000 people float it every summer. Our greatest canyon in Canada, most of you probably can't name, the Grand Canyon of the Stikine. In all of history, less than 50 kayakers of world-class capacity have gotten through. No rafts ever made it. It's a K2 of whitewater challenges. Only 4 tall tan men have ever walked the length of the canyon. This is a kind of place that you can't even imagine the beauty that is at stake. Right across from the home where I live is a mountain known to the Tahltan people as Tolagan, the beautiful valley. It is a wildlife sanctuary in the sky. It is a residence of the largest population of stone sheep in the world. It has huge populations of grizzly bear, wolf. It's a place that in any other world would be preserved for the natural wonder that it is. And yet, Imperial Metals, the 75th largest Canadian mining company, which basically translates into meaning six blokes on a golf course, have secured the rights to put an open pit copper and gold mine that will process 30,000 tons of rock a day for 30 years, generating 200 million tons of waste rock that will be burying an alpine lake, which is the site of archaeological remains and a fishery that is active, a lake that drains into 9 headwater lakes of the Iskut River that in turn drain into the mighty Stikine River, one of our salmon rivers of home. They will cover moose habitat with 300 million tons of waste rock, and in doing so, destroy the habitat of a wildlife sanctuary in the sky of one of the most charismatic wildlife ungulates in the world. Imperial Metals sailed through the environmental assessment process. What exactly, one wonders, would it take to not get through an environmental process in Canada if your very project design calls for the dismantling of an iconic mountain? I remember I was in the lodge of and that mine site, just to be transparent, that open pit is within 3 miles of the home that I've lived in 35 years and raised my children. I was in a neighboring lodge one day where I was thinking about an old friend of mine, Mike Jones, who had died on his trap line. He went through the ice, and 90 feet of snow had fallen on Bowser Lake that winter. The Mounties couldn't get in to find his body until spring. I was in his lodge thinking about Mike. He was my closest friend. And I noticed this character in the corner drinking a cup of tea, a stranger. And then this woman walked in. And I could tell from her carriage that she was an engineer for the mining company. Now, in the old days, engineers, and I used to be one, would wear hard hats and fluorescent vests and steel-toed boots. Now they all look like they come out of a bloody Patagonia catalog, you know. But I knew who she was. And I'm a fly on the wall where they begin this breathless conversation. This is what the conversation went. Wow. Did you? What? No. Have you ever seen so many wild sheep? No. I must have counted 30 grizzly bear. I know, and I saw at least 100 wolves. I've never seen so much wildlife. Have you ever been in a more beautiful place? Ever been up here? No, I've never been north of Prince George. How about you? No, I once got to Williams Lake, never up here. And here they were having this breathless conversation about the most beautiful place either had seen, and yet it was their bureaucratic and corporate mission, because he was the deputy minister of mines, as it turned out, and she was the engineer for the mining company, and it was their corporate and bureaucratic mission to destroy the place that they could not stop praising breathlessly. And at the moment I felt, well, maybe they'll get the irony and just get out of this country and leave their schemes behind. But of course, they didn't. And that mine, unless we stop it, will go into production. You know how it's going to go into production? Because you are spending $404 million to extend the BC power grid, the Northwest Transmission Line, to nowhere. You don't know this, but you are. It's going to a place called Bob Quinn Lake, where there's nothing but a highway yard. But that's far enough north that it would allow all these mining companies to build their own lines down to plug in. So there'll be no talk of subsidy. There'll be talk of free enterprise. But of that $404 million, you also don't know that $130 million of it comes from the Green Fund, specifically set aside by the federal parliament to green our carbon economy. We are investing it in the extension of the BC hydro grid on the rationale that we will get 340 tall tent Indians at the reserve of Iskut off diesel generating power, and thus reduce the carbon footprint of an area of land the size of Switzerland, which is the home to 1,500 people. Well, of course, that's not going to happen. What is happening is we are subsidizing the destruction of your patrimony. And you know, I remember we've gone through in this quadrant of British Columbia, Enbridge is only the latest mega project. We've lived through billion-dollar railroads that went to nowhere without a mile of track being laid. We've lived through plans to put seven dams on the Iskut and the Stikine, inundating the greatest canyon in Canada. All of these mega development projects collapsed under the weight of their own stupidity. But during the course of the fighting against that dam in the 1970s, I attended a meeting at Iskut. And this young hippie back to the lander stood up and, in what he thought was a gesture of solidarity, said that if they build these dams, we're just gonna have to leave this country. And this tall tan youth in immense dignity stood up immediately thereafter and said, you know, partner, that's the difference between me and you. If they build these dams, I'll still be here. The American poet Gary Snyder said, the best thing we could do for the environment is stay put. And when I knew that I would be staying put with my family on Yalui Lake, even though that copper and gold mine might be adjacent to my land, it was a moment that my youngest daughter disappeared on the lake one night just last summer. This was a remarkable young girl, and you know, with tall tan people, they always say that, you know, they were an Athabascan hunting people, so if you had 10 kids, you let someone else raise them. If they only had a couple, kids got traded around all the time. It was a way that a hunting people maintained the solidarity of their community. But there was always that sense that there was a child who would never leave by your side, the one who would stay by you. And this younger daughter of mine always was the one that at the Hena, Alec Jack, the old chief from Iskut, always said was going to stay by you. And one day when she was really little, she had disappeared from our property, and it took me, she was only 4 or 5 at the time, and it took me about 6 hours to find her way up the creek. and she had her purple bonnet on and her work gloves, and she was kneeling over a dead black bear cub trying to stroke it back to life. And I immediately began to look for the boar that undoubtedly had killed that cub and now threatened my daughter. But when I later told old man Alec about that, he took it as a sign of what I was not sure. But I came to understand in the loyalty that Raina grew up with to that spirit of place. And last summer when she took a chestnut canoe out one night and hadn't come back from, and it got dark, and just a week before, two of the world-class kayakers who had successfully run the canyon had tipped that same canoe, and I had had to get them out of the lake on the edge of hypothermia. So I went out to see what had happened to my youngest daughter, and I went to the place that I knew she would probably have gone to, her favorite place in the lake, where she could tie the canoe up to a snag and a game trail, skirts of spruce onto a kind of a promontory from which you can look over the vast expanse and see our lodge across the lake, nestled in the flanks of the mountain, the Sky Mountain, known to the Taltan. And when I came up to her, I found her weeping profoundly. And when I asked as a father the obvious question, she simply said, "Daddy, this is my home. This is my land. This is the vortex of my life. This is where I want to live and where I want to die." And it was in that moment that I knew that no matter what happened with these mines, we would never abandon that place and we would never abandon our Taltan brothers and sisters. And even if I wasn't alive to experience the return of silence to our lake, daughters would be alive and their daughters would be alive. And that's exactly what the Taltan elders mean when they say, "This is our home. This land is our kitchen. We have nowhere else to go." So how would it be if we had some kind of new way of thinking in Canada that said before any mineral development or any natural gas development could go in, all the corporate board members of that entity had to bring all of their children to the land, live on the land, and be with the First Nations of that land, and at some point in time, allow the children to get together and make the kind of deal that children always make, fair and just, so that for every tree cut in Heisla land, a rose bush would fall in a garden in Rosedale in Toronto. For every drop of toxic waste that went into a river or a lake in Taltan country, a drop went into a swimming pool at the local YMCA where the children of that corporate figure recreated. Maybe then we would come up with a new valuation of landscape, not that would say we would stop these kinds of developments, but we would actually be more cautious in where we put them. To put a mine on Totigan Mountain is like drilling for oil in the Sistine Chapel. And this idea of accommodation and consultation, as Gerald suggested, accommodation being sold to the First Nations essentially is, what size crumbs do you want to get from the table? Consultation with who and for whose purpose has become an utter charade. In Taltan country, when I went to see Premier Campbell, you may remember that photograph in the slideshow of a very handsome young man with a 30-30 across his lap. Did you happen to notice that? Well, that's actually my closest brother up there, Oscar Dennis. That, incidentally, that photograph turned up in National Geographic magazine, and women from all over the world descended on Iskut. And I'd get calls from Oscar saying, "Hey, wait, there's this, he still calls women chicks, so excuse me," he said, "Wait, there's this chick from Poland coming to see me." And I say, "Oscar, you know, you just had a Russian one last week. You don't even speak Polish or Russian." He said, "Well, they don't really come for conversation." But I showed that picture to Premier Campbell because he thought I was coming at him as an environmentalist, but I was actually coming at him as a local person who was speaking for my friends, and the issue for me was human rights. In the 5 years before that photograph was taken, Oscar's one brother hung himself in the basement of his mother's house. His other brother died 10 feet from shore because he never learned how to swim. His fictive brother died due to medical malpractice at a hospital in Prince Rupert. They thought he was a drunk Indian when he in fact had a severe seizure. His sister got an ICBC settlement and ended up dying of prostitution and drugs on the streets of Prince George, and Oscar's only daughter had blown her head off playing Russian roulette with a handgun. And I said to Premier Campbell, in those 5 years, Barrick Gold at Eskay Creek took 400 tons of gold and 5,000 tons of silver out of their land at today's market value, $25 billion, and not one iota of infrastructure at his community changed. No hockey rink, no swimming pool, no trust funds for kids to go to college, no trust funds for people to get low-interest loans in a sustainable economy. Those who say that this resistance is promoted by foreign activists, my God, I wish it was. We have been fighting off Royal Dutch Shell for 10 years in the sacred headwaters. We haven't gotten one penny from one NGO in North America anytime, and that is our strength. That's what they can't understand. When the Tahltan people first took to the blockade, keeping Royal Dutch Shell, the second largest corporation, out of the sacred headwaters, no one could understand where this resistance had come from. It had come from the women who stood up in their blankets, and it came from the magic of the place. And as the resistance grew, there was only one discordant note. It was July, the month when the sockeye run on the Stikine. Everybody wanted to be down on the river putting up their winter fish. This was a kind of an awkwardness, but then the miracle happened. A big 18-wheel double tandem truck roared down the Stuart-Cassiar Highway, sacrificed itself by rolling over right at the base of Tottingen Mountain. The driver wasn't hurt, but his entire load spilled out over the roadway, and what he was carrying was several hundred tons of fresh salmon from Alaska, destined for the Seattle market. So the people didn't go to the river came to them. And before you knew it, the blockade site was colored spectacled gold from all the sockeye drying in the boreal spruce forest. This was a miraculous sign that signaled the turning of the ways. And so even as I speak, that resistance is ongoing. So Enbridge is just a symptom of a bigger question. And the bigger question is, what kind of country do you want to have as Canadians? This idea that the spinmeisters in Calgary promote ethical oil sands as opposed to tar sands. Have you ever held a piece of bitumen? That is tar. It is not oil. And when they suggest they're simply helping the global economy as if they're benevolent conveyors of an essential product, they're telling the truth. But of course, behind that is also their own personal desire for gain, corporate profits, for their benefit, not necessarily for the benefit of our country. So I think the most important thing about a panel like this and an audience like you being here tonight is this is just a sign that finally Canadians are waking up. We're leaving, at least in our imaginations, the confines of the urban spaces that most of us dwell in, and recognizing that in the North there are people paying attention, and in their attention is has come from that attention has come about so many initiatives that threaten the legacy of your own grandparents. And at the very least, what we must demand is that these issues become part of a public debate. You know, when we, for example, took the case of the Red Chris mine to court, challenging the federal government for not having done its proper environmental assessment and simply accepting the provincial assessment done by the provincial authorities, our case went all the way to the Canadian Supreme Court, and in court we won. We won in the sense that the ruling was made that in the future, that there should have been a federal assessment, and in the future for such projects there would have to be one, but then in this kind of inimitably Canadian moment of compromise, the justices reclused Red Chris from having to be part of the very federal consideration that the case had rotated upon. So, you know, this is just another way of keeping the word of these projects from getting to the public at large. As Canadians, we have a right to know, and we have a right in a democracy to be part of a public dialogue over the future of our own country. And I hope that this movement will spread like a wave across all quarters of this country, because this is not a British Columbia issue, it's not a Manitoba issue, it's not a Newfoundland issue, it's an issue for all of us. And we've written a book called The Sacred Headwaters, and we wrote that book very explicitly with the idea that if we couldn't get all of you up to this remarkable part of Canada, we would bring it to you. But you can come up and visit us. My fishing lodge is always available and open to anyone who can find me. So what I'm saying to you, get on the road, discover your country, and then stand up for it, and don't let these people take it down. Thank you.